The idea that hundreds of thousands of Israelites passed through the Red Sea is crazy. The Bible says that there were 603,000 males, which means over 2 million people who passed through those waters. It most likely would have taken several weeks for all those people just to cross. The whole idea is crazy.
Based on recent developments in physical oceanography and meteorology, we can prove today that crossing of the Red Sea would have been possible.
From the burning bush to the parting of the Red Sea, the story of the Israelites' exodus out of Egypt has been a constant source of disagreement among the experts.
The Bible gives a remarkable account about the man known as Moses. According to the story, the Israelites were a people enslaved in Egypt. They were growing in numbers, much to the concern of their Egyptian slave masters. Because of this, the Pharaoh ordered all of the Hebrew children to be slain. A young mother, one of the enslaved Israelites, could no longer protect her infant son. She put him in a basket and set him afloat in the Nile River near the palace of the Pharaoh. A princess of Egypt found the basket and took the infant to raise as her own. She called the child Moses. Raised in royal surroundings, it was not until Moses reached manhood that he discovered the truth of his heritage.
The story of the Israelites' exodus out of Egypt has been a constant source of disagreement among the experts. Proof of the story of Exodus in the Bible depends on the answers to three questions. Was Moses a real person? Was there really an enslaved people called Israelites? And was it possible that the Red Sea actually parted, as stated in the Bible? Some critics express doubts that Moses and the Israelites crossed the Red Sea at all. Others do not believe any part of the Exodus. But recently, there has been the discovery of some remarkable proof.
There are certain hallmark pieces of pottery that we look for in attempting to trace the Exodus event and the migration of the Israelites into the land of Canaan. One of these pieces is this very nice pilgrim flask that's very nicely painted, and the shape itself apparently indicated the product that was shipped in it. It comes from Cyprus, but it's important for dating the other material that we find in connection with the Israelites. Another piece that we have is the Philistine beer jug. The Philistines were very fond of drinking beer. Was fermented right in the jug, and you can see it was sieved as it was poured out into the drinking vessel itself. The Israelites copied the Philistine ware, which was very highly painted, and came out with a very poor reproduction. So we can always tell when we come into a site that the Israelites themselves have now moved on to this site. Daily there are more and more pieces of evidence that are being excavated that are helping to demonstrate the fact that the Israelites came in the Exodus and settled in the land of Canaan.
One of the interesting questions that Emmanuel Anati has answered in his research, and he's one of the top Sinai archaeologists, is the question, what were the Israelites doing during the 40 years that they were wandering in a desert? Well, Dr. Anati has discovered something like 30,000 rock inscriptions, which he dates to the time period of the Exodus, and which he believes the Israelites carved on those hot, weathered rocks.
New findings are being unearthed at several archaeological sites, such as the unusual pottery items in the rock drawings, which give hard evidence that the Exodus really did happen. But even as the validity of the Exodus is being scientifically proven, the controversy over the parting of the Red Sea is heating up.
The idea that the Red Sea could have parted into two walls of water, as portrayed in movies by Hollywood movie makers like Cecil B. DeMille, is just not credible.
At this site in 1799, Napoleon's engineers discovered an underwater ridge some 600 feet wide that extended from shore to shore. His engineers calculated the right time for crossing this 5.2-mile strip when the east wind would blow sufficiently to clear the seabed of water. Napoleon, however, barely escaped with his life when a sudden change in the wind's direction brought an onrush of water that covered the strip in just a matter of minutes.
Recently, Professor Doran Knopf of Florida State University, along with Dr. Norman Paldor of Israel, revealed their findings on the Red Sea crossing to the world press.
Dr. Paldor and I were not so much interested in whether crossing of the Red Sea occurred or not, but we were intrigued by the possibility that perhaps there is some explanation for a similar process. So what we did, we developed what we call in physical oceanography a mathematical model of the part of the Red Sea where many people believe that crossing could have been. Okay, what we have here now is a physical model of the Red Sea. The deep part supposed to represent the main body of the Red Sea, which is about 2,000 or 3,000 feet deep. And the shallow part, with the one with the sloping bottom, supposed to represent the Gulf of Suez, which is much shallower, as we said before. The average depth of the Gulf of Suez is about 100 feet, and the length is few hundred miles. Okay, what we have in addition to this, we have here, we introduced here an artificial ridge, which you see right here, and the depth of the water above that artificial ridge is only about 10 feet high. Okay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to let the wind blow from here, and you will see how the water recedes and, in fact, exposes the ridge to the air. Okay, so what you can see now is that most of the water, in fact, to the left of the ridge is blown away. There is still some water there, and you see that there is a exposed area right there. All right? So the idea is that the Israelis crossed on this part of the ridge which was exposed, and they saw water on the two sides, right? They saw the water on the left side of the ridge and the water on the right side. And I'm going to cut the wind off now, and I'm going to do that abruptly, and you will see how it comes back. So let's do that. And of course, what happens after that is that when the wind relaxes, the water wants to come back to the position that it had before, and it does that via a gravity wave, which moves at the speed we calculated to be like 15 feet per second or so, which is, of course, a speed that one cannot escape.
Oceanographers have established scientifically how the Israelites crossed the Red Sea in their escape from the pursuing Egyptians. The worldwide media coverage of the Knopf-Paldor experiments and findings leave no doubt that the Israelites could have crossed the Red Sea exactly as described in the Bible. You have seen and heard both sides of the dispute. Is the Bible a complete and accurate history? Don't decide yet. This is only the beginning.